I do not, but you don't need to do that. What? You should be able to hit on that link. And if you put on that link, it brings you up to another link. Open Zoom meeting. It works on mine. It says, so are you?
I've got 10 attendees. Hey, Larry.
Good evening, Sarah.
Just a second. Folks, if you're watching at home, if you bear with us while we're moving people around and getting people into the conference. Oh, there's Councilor Castro.
All right, Bob is there, Craig. We don't have quorum yet.
Good evening.
Hey, Bob.
Bob, we're live.
All right, good evening.
Just telling you that now.
I expected as much, yeah.
Wait a minute, I gotta fix this first.
I'm trying to see people who are invited. I'm looking for Jay and for Andy.
Rob, I think Jeff Dirk will be able to will speak on behalf of Vinas instead of Andy.
Okay. And there was somebody else from your team, Jay?
Jay Szymanski, yes.
Szymanski? I don't see him popping on yet.
Phil is there.
Missing, it looks like we're missing, Tony, I guess.
Tony will be a few minutes late.
All right.
I have 1, 2, 3.
You have four.
You got four board members.
So you let me know when to begin, sir.
There's Jason Anski.
Rob, there's several people from the mayor's office. Do you want to move them?
I see Danielle. I'm going to, and.
And John.
I'll pull them up. What the heck of it? Although actually they should probably stay as, I'm gonna push them back down. Sorry guys.
You wanna move Councilor Nicastro?
We will once.
Well, Councilor Thompson's been moved.
Oh, okay. Move Councilor Nicastro. I didn't see Councilor Thompson in there.
Either Councilor Thompson goes back or Councilor Nicastro.
Nope. Do that.
Oh, that's hot.
Wow. And flash the screen one more time. We're getting fancy. Mr. Chairman, would you like to wait for Tony? She should be right here.
Certainly, whatever you wish, yeah.
She should be here just shortly. Apologize to the folks who are watching from home. And Mr. Chairman, I also have a statement once we get
through the prepared statement for the coronavirus.
Yes, sir.
All right.
If you don't mind.
I will fit you in there.
All right. Thank you. Oh, you didn't move. Councilor Nicastro, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were.
I did. I just did.
Sorry about that.
Good evening, ma'am. Well, actually, Mr. Chairman, you can open the meeting and start your
statement.
Coronavirus statement.
All right, well, good evening to all. This is a special meeting of the Brockton Planning Board. This is Thursday, January the 21st, 2021, and the time is approximately 6:05. And I have a prepared statement to read at this time. I am calling this January the 21st, 2021 meeting of the Brockton Planning Board to order. My name is Bob Pelagi, and I am the chairman of the board. This meeting is being recorded. In accordance with the governor's order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, general law, chapter 30A, section 20, relating to the 2020 novel coronavirus outbreak emergency, the January 21st, 2021 public meeting of the Brockton Planning Board shall be physically closed to the public to avoid group congregation. Real-time public participation and comment can be addressed to the Planning Board utilizing the Zoom virtual meeting software for remote access. This application will allow users to view the meeting and send a comment or question to the chair via the question and answer function. Submitted text comments will be read into the record at the appropriate points in the meeting. For those of you joining us by phone who want to ask a question, press *9 to raise your hand. A copy of the recording and transcript will be posted to the city's webpage within 72 hours. All votes will be done via roll call to ensure count accuracy. At this time, I will conduct a quorum call. Board members, please respond in the affirmative to indicate your attendance at this meeting. Larry Hassan.
Here.
Tony Gonzalez.
Here.
Reggie Thomas.
Reggie's here.
Are you muted, Reggie? We can't hear you.
Okay.
You need to respond, but are you without audio? You need to respond by voice.
He's saying here.
Well,
and Craig Pina?
Here.
And Bob Pelagi is here. With five members voting in the affirmative, I declare we have a quorum. Tonight's agenda is a one-item agenda, and it is the application of POUA Holdings LLC for a proposed 40-yard development at 223-261 Thatcher Street within the Thatcher Street Smart Growth Overlay District. Proposal is for a 175-unit mixed-income residential development. And I believe you want to make a statement at this time, Mr. May.
Yes, I just would like to refresh the audience and the board about 40R and what we're doing here tonight. So the statement officially is, tonight the planning board will hear a presentation from the developer, Planning Office of Urban Affairs, and their consultants as part of their application for a 175-unit multifamily residential development at 223 through 261 Thatcher Street under the Thatcher Street Smart Growth Overlay Zoning, which is Brockton City Code Section 27-140 through Section 27-164. The Thatcher Street Overlay District was established by City Council on December 26, 2017, and later approved by the Commonwealth Department of Housing and Community Development, DHCD, on March 7, 2018. The zoning ordinance establishes permitted uses, lot standards, design and design guidelines, which must be met for the project to be considered by right. The planning department and an independent third-party review consultant find that the application meets the use, lot size, lot standards, and design guidelines, and therefore the project is considered by right subject to site plan review. As the name suggests, site plan review is an opportunity for the planning board to analyze the project's application, supporting documents, and technical reports. It's also an opportunity to take testimony from abutters and other interested parties concerning the project and its potential impact. Once the planning board has completed its review, considered public testimony, and feel that the applicant has answered the board's concerns, the board will take one of three actions based on the criteria established in the ordinance. It will either approve the application with conditions, or deny the application. The board shall approve the development project upon the following findings. The applicant has submitted the required fee and information as required by the city, and B, the proposed development project is described in the application, meets all of the requirements and standards set forth in this article, and applicable design standards and or waivers for or for a waiver that has been granted thereof, and C, an extraordinary adverse any extraordinary adverse potential impacts of the project on nearby properties have been adequately mitigated. The board may also impose conditions on a development project as necessary to ensure compliance with the ordinance and the design standards set forth in Section 27-145, or to mitigate any extraordinary adverse impact of the development project on nearby properties, insofar as such conditions are compliant with the provisions of Mass General Law Chapter 40R and associated Chapter 40R regulations, and do not unduly restrict opportunities for development. The board may also allow construction of the approved development project to be phased for the purpose of coordinating the development project with A, anticipated off-site or on-site infrastructure improvements, B, securing financing subsidies related to affordable housing restrictions, and C, the review of other related permit applications on the site, including but not limited to applications for subdivision, applications for before the Conservation Control Board, the Board of Health, or any other public state agency. Finally, the board may deny the application for site plan review pursuant to this article only if it finds one or more of the following. A, the development project does not meet the conditions and requirements set forth in the ordinance and applicable design standards. B, the applicant failed to submit information and fees required by the ordinance and necessary for the adequate and timely review of the design for development project, of the development project or potential development project impact. And C, it is not possible to adequately mitigate significant adverse development project impact on nearby properties by means of suitable conditions. So that is in a nutshell why we are here tonight. It sounds technical, it is. In the folder online that is available to everybody on the city's planning page, there are copies and have been copies of the application, all the construction drawings, the technical reviews submitted by Beta Group, a wetlands letter of notice of non-applicability, and other important documents that we have all been considering these last few months. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this indulgence and hand that back over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. May. So I'm looking at a lot of faces on my screen here. So for the purposes of identification, could everyone who was on the applicant team just raise your hand so that we can get an idea of who you are? I recognize Mr. Burke and the others. Okay, that way that the planning board can identify who was on the applicant's side of the project. And I see a representative from Beta that's with us this evening. Good evening. So who on the applicant's
I was going to say, Mr. Grogan, would you like to introduce your team, please?
Sure. Thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Chairman and members of the Planning Board, Rob May and your staff for the opportunity this evening to present to you the Thatcher Street Housing Development. Obviously, while we wish we could make this presentation in person, we're grateful for everyone taking the time this evening. My name is Bill Grogan. I'm the president of the Planning Office for Urban Affairs, and we're excited to be here tonight with our experienced development team to share with you our plans for the Thatcher Street Housing Development. I'll briefly introduce team members, then turn it over briefly to Jim Burke to make an introduction, and then we can go through our presentation. Tonight we have with us my colleague Shayna Corman Houston from the Planning Office, Brian Kucher, who's our civil engineer from Horsley Witten, Jay Szymanski, our architect from the architectural team, Jeff Dirk, our traffic engineer from Vinass and Associates, and Jim Burke, our attorney. And Jim, I'll turn it over to you to do a brief introduction, and then I can take it back from you.
Thank you very much, Bill, and Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board. It is my pleasure to assist and represent Planning Office of Urban Affairs in this exciting project that is scheduled for Thatcher Street. The Planning Office of Urban Affairs is a nonprofit corporation that was started and is an affiliation with the Archdiocese of Boston. And its purpose is to provide affordable and decent housing for members of the community, Commonwealth of Massachusetts, especially those that may not have full resources to enter into our housing markets. I am pleased that this specific project is finally before the Planning Board. It may be one of the most thoroughly vetted non-projects that we've ever had in the history of the Planning Board. In fact, the planning department, as it was stated by the city planner, made a determination that it would seek to expand an overlay district for a 40R district in the Thatcher Street overlay, submitted materials to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Its application ultimately was approved. And in various proceedings in the city of Brockton, it was introduced to the city council. It required and had a planning board hearing before this body, which may have had some different members. It had an ordinance committee hearing. It was open to the public. It went through readings of the city council, and ultimately, because of a uniqueness of the statute, was required to return again to the planning board, where it once more was generally vetted by members of the planning board and various members of the community, as well as assisted by planning offices consultants. So we are here today. We're here today after there was a lengthy litigation which attempted to deprive the city of the 40A ordinance. That in fact was dismissed in 2019 by a judge of the Superior Court. And in fact, the 40R ordinance remains effective, and it has been effective since its initiation in roughly 2017. I would suggest to the board that what you have here today, and it was an excellent summary by the city planner, is a project that is essentially as of right. It is as of right because the ordinance established the general purpose was to provide suitable and affordable housing within its 40R district. The 40R legislation provides for the ability of individuals of moderate means to secure housing under the utilization of the 40R statute. It authorizes communities that determine that they want to participate in that process by providing financial benefits to them based on their approvals and based on the units that are ultimately approved. The city of Brockton has in fact received and had the benefit of the participation in 40R with financial funds coming to the city of Brockton as a result of the 40R's participation. So essentially what the ordinance has created is a minimum standard. It does not prevent a developer from providing more than is required under the ordinance, but it provides a minimum standard that this board would look to determine if it meets compliance. In fact, I think under site plan approval of our ordinance, it suggests it's the authority, approving authority's authorization, which is the board, of the proposed development based on a finding of compliance with this article. And what has happened here in this project is we have thoroughly complied with the article. In fact, I'm going to rely on the consultants and with more expertise, but there are no waivers that have been submitted before the planning board for their requirement. And basically we have met all minimum standards and exceeded some standards in relation to what is required under the project. So therefore the board is looking at an as of right project and is looking at a project that has already been vetted by various elected officials who have provided excellent insight. The Planning Office of Urban Affairs has listened to that insight, has made changes from the proposal that was there approximately a year ago by reducing the footprint of the project so that there is more green space, all of which will be decided and explained to you by representative of the consultant group. So therefore, I'm going to ask you to keep in mind when you review this excellent proposal that it meets all required minima of the ordinance. And as a result, with the exception of, I'm sure, the insightful comments of the board, which may be of assist to us, that the project should be approved and should be approved as it currently exists. So I'm going to give it to Bill and ask him to go ahead and identify our presentation group and who will lead off. And great. Bill, go ahead.
One second, Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
before
sir.
We hand it off to Bill, I neglected to say that we are in a webinar format, which allows the panelists all to talk to each other and have their screens available. Other people, the public, are in what they call attendee mode. And what we're going to have tonight is the presentation given by the applicant. There'll be a series of questions and answers from the planning board and the applicant conversation, at which point later this evening, we will open it up for public testimony. At that point in time, if you have a comment or would like to make testimony, we ask you to use the raise your hand function, which is if you go to the bottom of your screen or move your mouse to the bottom of the screen, you'll see a little hand raise emoji. If you push that, it lights up on my screen, and I know that you want to ask a question. At that point, we'll unlock your microphone. You'll be allowed to provide your testimony. And then after that point in time, you'll be muted. If you have another question, you can raise your hand again. I do have one person with their hand open or up right now, and I'm going to ask that person to wait until we get ready. Thank you very much to open it up for public comment. Also at the bottom of your screen, you'll next to that raise your hand, you should see a Q&A button. And if you press that button, you'll be able to write comments. We will then read those comments into the record and try to answer your questions online. So thank you very much. I apologize for that interruption. And Bill, I'll turn that back over to you.
Great. Thank you, Rob. I would ask Jay Szymanski if he could share the screen to present the proposal so that everyone can go along with us as we walk through the presentation. And I just want to acknowledge as well, one of my other colleagues, Dan Rabinovitz, is in the audience as well with the Planning Office for Urban Affairs. As Jim mentioned, the Planning Office for Urban Affairs is the nonprofit housing developer and social justice ministry associated with the Archdiocese of Boston. Our mission, as Jim mentioned, is to create high quality housing where people can live with dignity and respect in homes that they can afford in order to create vibrant and healthy communities. We recently celebrated our 50th anniversary, and over that period of time, we've developed nearly 3,000 units of housing across the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. In all of our developments, we work to create housing that will be integrated into and become a part of the larger community and really be a long-term asset within the community. I think the current public health crisis certainly underscores the importance of providing safe, high-quality housing for all. And this proposed housing at Thatcher Street Housing Development will be an important effort to make sure everyone has access to a place that they can call home. We're extremely excited about the opportunity to come to Brockton. And here our focus has been on developing housing that can be available to a broad range of households who currently reside and work in Brockton. And we believe it's an ideal location for this type of housing. And we're excited to partner with the city in this effort. The Thatcher Street Housing Development is located on Thatcher Street on property that's currently owned by the Poor Sisters of Jesus Crucified and the Sorrowful Mother. And the property is located, as Jim mentioned, within a 40-yard district that was passed and approved by the city council. This district provides the framework for the redevelopment of the property and outlines the parameters and requirements for development. And throughout 2020, this past year, our development team has worked to develop a site plan design that would comply with the guidelines and requirements set forth in the 40-yard district. At the same time, we've been committed to developing a design that respects the existing site, reduces the overall impacts to the site, meets the goals of sustainability, improved public infrastructure, and protection of natural resources, and does so in a compact development of multifamily residential housing. More recently, over the last 5 months, we performed additional investigative site work, refined and improved the site design, and address various comments received, including those from the city and their peer reviewer. I'd like to briefly provide an overview of the development, and then I'll turn it over to Brian Kucher, our civil engineer, to walk through the design in more detail. As Jim mentioned, Thatcher Street Housing Development is a 175-unit multifamily residential development that complies with the requirements of the Thatcher Street Smart Growth Overlay District and will create a healthy, vibrant, and diverse community. As I mentioned, we're in a period of time with the development of stable, high quality housing that is available to a broad range of households is critically important. And the redevelopment of the property in this manner will provide housing in an attractive and convenient setting. All of the housing that the planning office develops is professionally managed by third party property managers. And we look forward to being a long-term steward of this housing and a community partner. As shown on the site plan, the development will provide a diversity of unit types spread across five buildings in a campus-like setting, with the existing Our Lady of Sorrowful's convent building acting as a centerpiece and the development's identity. The development will also include 185 parking spaces, landscape open spaces for residents of the development, and accommodations for an internal bus stop. And I think as we walk through this, we'll be highlighting some of the design and site improvements that are incorporated into the development plans, including minimizing as much as possible the overall amount of impervious pavement, maximizing the amount of open space and green space for residents of the development to create a streetscape feel along the proposed roadways, keeping all of the proposed structures, infrastructure, and grading outside of the 100-foot wetland buffer. And in addition to these improvements, we've incorporated an extension of the Brockton Area Transit bus route in order to improve the connection to public transportation by designing the site to accommodate an internal bus stop. We've had conversations with BAT, and they've indicated their support for adding this loop into their service. Now I'd like to turn it over to Brian Kuchar to discuss the site design in some more detail. Brian?
Thank you, Bill. For the record, my name is Brian Kuchar. I'm from the Horsley Witten Group. I am an associate principal, registered landscape architect, and professional engineer. And as Bill mentioned, the project proposes to convert the existing convent building and to construct four new affordable residential housing buildings along with associated parking, interior road, and sidewalk layout. For frame of reference, building A in the center of the plan here is the converted convent. Building B1 and B2 are the proposed townhouse style units. And building C1 and C2 would be the elevator building units located throughout the site. The design team has worked closely with the city to improve the overall site design by reducing the amount of paved surfaces to minimize the project's overall impacts. These improvements include the reduction of large parking areas through the use of on-street parking in smaller lots for a more compact and pedestrian-oriented development. We decreased the overall amount of paved surfaces by 23%. We have a 20% increase in the overall amount of programmed open space for the residents of the development, as well as an overall increase of 50% in green space. The use of natural stormwater management solutions are incorporated into the landscape to maximize both stormwater treatment and infiltration on site. We've also removed all the proposed paved surface structures, infrastructure, and grading from the 100-foot wetland buffer located in the southwest corner of the site. I also want to note that the wetlands have been delineated by our wetland biologist. They were reviewed by the city's consultant, and we also submitted a request for determination of applicability to the Conservation Commission, which confirmed our delineated wetlands boundaries. It's also important to note that the designs have been adjusted to address and incorporate review comments received from various city departments, as well as the city's peer review consultant. So now I would just like to walk you through the circulation of the site. There are three access points to enter and exit from a vehicular standpoint, and they're located along Thatcher Street as is being shown right now. And there's three main interior roads that provide vehicular circulation throughout the development. The roads also have sidewalks for pedestrian circulation. So we've accounted for both the vehicular movement and pedestrians as well. The parking is located on street to encourage traffic calming, reduce vehicular speed, and making it a more friendly pedestrian development by creating a streetscape along the interior roadways with sidewalks and lighting. As Bill mentioned, we have a total of 185 spaces, and they're provided in three smaller parking lots, 73 spaces, and the on-street parking, as I mentioned, which accounts for 112 of those spaces. Sidewalks are provided along the three access drives, as well as along Thatcher Street. Sidewalks will be maintained on Thatcher Street, and we also provide an additional extension along, yes, thank you, along Thatcher Street in the area of the Massasoit College entrance. Some additional public improvements also include, as Bill mentioned, the internal Brockton Area Transit bus stop that's denoted by the red star. We also have the extension of the sidewalk, as I mentioned, and we maintain and improve the current crosswalk that exists on Thatcher Street as well for pedestrian safety. The stormwater management is provided through a series of above and below ground stormwater infiltration and green stormwater infrastructure practices and integrated into the overall site design and landscape. The design includes natural practices such as vegetated infiltration basins, which you can see in the upper right corner, in the lower left. We also have bioretention areas, which can be seen next to building A in the lower left corner, in the parking lot off of building C2, and bioswales along what is called East Road or the lower loop road, and some bioretention areas located in the parking lot for C1, as well as a bioretention area located at the entrance at the eastern, the western side or the left hand of your screen. The landscape design is closely incorporated into the stormwater management and emphasizes the use of native plantings and strives to integrate the proposed development into the local surroundings. The intent is to create passive landscape that complements the proposed building architecture, incorporates good environmental practices, and provides open space for the development's residents. Both mowed lawns and meadows, as shown in the light green and olive green areas, are proposed for the areas that would not be filled with shrubs and trees. Street trees are provided at a maximum spacing of 35 feet on center, and the existing screening along Thatcher Street is left in place and supplemented in areas where parking is located close to the road to provide additional screening. That covers the site design and layout, and I think at this time I'll now turn it over to Jay Zemanski, the architect from the architectural team. Thank you.
Thanks, Brian. Again, my name is Jay Zemanski. I'm a principal with the architectural team. I just want to, a lot of the things Bill and Brian have already hit on, but I'll quickly go through the site layout first, and then we'll look at a series of pedestrian level images that showed the architecture. So in general, the site design was formed around the concept of providing multiple different building types and unit types that are centered around the existing convent building. So building A in this plan is the convent building. It's three stories, includes 39 units. So all of those are renovated units. So they'll have very unique character and very different from new construction residential units. Also within building A is the repurposing of the chapel building, which is here, into residential amenity space. And that will also be used for community space. Buildings B1 and B2, as has been mentioned, are townhouse buildings. By that we mean each unit in those buildings has their own direct entrance from the street. So there are no internal corridors or circulation or elevators. You get directly into the unit from the outside. Ground floor units in both of these buildings have their own private patios on the back. And there are 15 units in each of these buildings. Building C1 is a three-story elevator building. And by that, we mean it has an internal circulation system, so an internal corridor with an elevator to access the upper floors. Ground level units, where possible, do have direct entrances as well as the internal corridor connection. C1 has 28 units in it. And C3 is also a three-story elevator building with 78 units. Again, the same principles apply: internal circulation with elevators to access the upper floors. Ground floor units, where possible, do have direct entrances. So they have an entrance on the exterior as well as the corridor entrance on the interior of the building. Brian mentioned the parking layout. Again, we tried to put as many parking spaces on the streets as possible for traffic calming to create a safer, more pedestrian-friendly development. Next, I'll go through a series of exterior renderings that show the development from the outside looking in, but also some images from within the development itself looking at the individual buildings. In the lower right corner, you'll see a site plan with a red arrow. The arrow indicates where this view is taken from. So this particular view is from Thatcher Street, which runs in the foreground here, about at the entrance to the college. So we're looking across the meadow grass that Brian mentioned to the back of one of the townhouse buildings. You can see the private patios on the rear of those buildings and some existing trees along Thatcher Street that we intend to maintain. I think what's important to note here is the setback that we're keeping from Thatcher Street to keep the buildings as far back from the surrounding neighborhood as possible and to provide as much open space as a buffer as possible. Mm-hmm. Moving westerly on Thatcher Street, here you can see where the location is on the site plan. So again, Thatcher is running in the foreground. This is the existing convent building with some existing trees and the townhouse buildings, the two B buildings here, and then the C2 building in the background. Moving down to the central entrance to the site at the convent location, and then in the background, the townhouse buildings and the C2 building. Moving further west on Thatcher, this is the existing chapel, again, being repurposed into community space and residential amenity space. Landscaping buffer that was added between Thatcher Street and the parking lot that's behind here, and then some existing mature trees that will be maintained. And just to the right on this image, you can see building C1. We're now further down Thatcher looking back towards the convent. So this is the convent building, the chapel building that we mentioned, and then building C1. And now to the westernmost entrance to the site and building C1 in the foreground. It's important to note here that each of the buildings takes architectural cues from its surroundings. So in this particular case, building C1 is adjacent to the chapel building and also adjacent to St. Joseph's next door, both of which have very low slope or flat roofs. So in this particular case, we chose to use a flat roof for building C1. And we're also bringing in materials and color choices from those buildings. So for example, the chapel has red brick exterior, so we're bringing in some red brick masonry onto this building. Vertical white accents on the chapel building. So we're starting to introduce some vertical accents on building C1. Again, the different buildings taking some of the characters of the buildings that are around them. Now moving into the site, you can see the location here. This is between the convent building, buildings B1 and C2. And again, you can see here that the architecture is a little bit different. We're taking the sloped roofs, the hip roof style, some of the dormers from the convent building and bringing those into the buildings that are further into the site. You can start to see here the individual entrances along the street to the C2 building and also the entries on the townhome buildings. So this view is sort of the deepest portion back into the site, looking up through C2 in the townhome buildings. You can see the chapel building in the background here. So again, this is another shot of the C2 building. So even though this is a three-story elevator building, we do have those individual entrances along the street. So along with the sort of traffic calming effects of parallel parking along the streets, the individual entrances along the street also adds to a more pedestrian-friendly development. So this image is looking between the two townhome buildings up at the chapel in the background. And again, the individual entrances to the townhouse buildings here. And that's the last architectural slide. I'll hand it over to Bill Grogan.
Great. Thank you, Jay. Now I'd like to ask Jeff Dirk to provide a brief overview of the traffic analysis that we have conducted. Jeff?
Okay, thanks, Bill. And good evening, members of the planning board. For the record, my name is Jeffrey Dirk. I'm the managing partner with Vanessa & Associates, and we're the transportation consultants for the project. And just, I guess, following on Rob's comments at the initial part of the introduction to the project, we've been working with the city's peer review consultant as a part of the transportation analyses that were done for the project itself, and have had the benefit of a peer review that was done to check the facts and findings of the analyses. The traffic study was prepared pre-COVID, and I think that's important to mention given the situation that we're in now. So all of the data collection was done prior to any of the implementation of the restrictions associated with the COVID-19 pandemic. And the college was in full session. So none of the traffic volumes that we used or based our analyses on were impacted by either COVID or vacations associated with public school or the college itself. So the transportation assessment that we had conducted essentially looked at the entirety of the Thatcher Street corridor, stretching from Pine Street all the way to the entrance and exit drives to the college itself. We did an extensive data collection effort that looked at not only motor vehicle traffic, but also pedestrians and bicycles, as well as the neighborhood streets that intersect Thatcher Street as well, just to see what the traffic patterns look like on those roadways themselves. So the project itself, as was described, in terms of the net increase in traffic that we're predicting and that we analyze as a part of the project, we're expecting that during the typical commuter peak hours, so this would be in the morning between 7 and 9, we expect the project will produce somewhere on the order of about 60 vehicle trips. And then evening, so this is 4 to 6 in the evening, a 1 hour period therein, we expect the project will produce approximately 76 vehicle trips. What I want to stress with regards to those numbers is it does not assume the BAT bus stop within the project site. This is a 40R development. And as you heard, we do expect that we are going to have a bus service within the site. If it's not within the site, certainly it is already driving by the site on Thatcher Street. Those traffic numbers I had mentioned, those will be reduced as a result of the opportunity and ability to be able to ride the BAT bus. So we're expecting the numbers will be much lower than what I had said. And that's the intent of the 40R development, is that it's transit oriented. You heard Brian talking about sidewalks. You saw some of the images of the infrastructure within the project site. This is going to be a very walkable and bikeable development as well. So not only are we connecting to a bus service, the walking and biking accommodations as well will also serve to be able to reduce some of the traffic volumes associated with the project. But even assuming none of those mode shifts as a part of the project, and as confirmed by the city's independent peer review consultant, the project was not shown to result in any changes in terms of increased delay or vehicle queuing at intersections. And what that really translated to is as we added that traffic onto the roadway network, and as you see, you know, the 60 to 70 vehicles, some of it's coming out at each of these access points. So there's 3 access points, and then it's dispersing itself. So some of it's turning right or left as it's exiting the development. So the numbers, as you get farther away from the site, they get smaller and smaller. And so as concluded by both ourselves and your peer review consultant, the net increase in delay that would result from the additional traffic from this project, and again, assuming no one rides the BAT bus, would be on the order of less than 5 seconds over the course of an hour. So as you're a commuter driving on these roadways and you're coming out to any of the intersections, so in particular the Thatcher Pine Street intersection, the delays that you experience today versus what you'll experience with the project is no more than an additional 5 seconds. So it's not a significant impact. And again, this was concluded and concurred with by the city's independent review consultant. So no increase in delay. And I think the other important thing is we looked at motor vehicle crash history, so safety along Thatcher Street. The city undertook a road safety audit of Thatcher Street in 2008 with the Old Colony Planning Council. That safety study resulted in some recommendations for enhanced signs and pavement markings. The city, in consultation with the Old Colony Planning Council, implemented those improvements. And the net result of that is that there are no high crash locations along this corridor. So safety has been improved as a result of those improvements that the city expended in terms of infrastructure. And we're planning to build upon that. So there will be enhanced signs and pavement markings as a part of this project. We've ensured that sight lines, both approaching the driveways of this project site as well as exiting the project site, exceed what is required for the actual speed of traffic on this roadway, which is somewhere closer to 40 miles an hour. So there's no existing safety issues. We're ensuring that the project itself is designed in a way that will be safe, that the access points will be safe, and it will exceed all of the required safety standards for the project. So that was the conclusion of our study. And I think most importantly, rather than hearing it from me, your own review consultant has confirmed those findings as well. So they're in concurrence with the statements that I've made. So I'll turn it back over to Bob, and I'll be happy, or to Bill, I'm sorry, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have later on in the presentation.
Great. Thanks, Jeff. Appreciate that. Before wrapping up the presentation, I just want to briefly highlight a few other noteworthy elements about the development. Want to mention that to the maximum extent permitted by law, we will be providing a local preference for up to 70% of the units. And the categories for the local preference will include current Brockton residents, municipal employees, employees of local businesses, including Massasoit College, and households for children in the city of Brockton's schools. Second, I think one of the unique elements about the or features about the development is the establishment of a board of managers within the ownership entity that will own the housing development. This board of managers will include a representative from the Sisters of Jesus Crucified and a representative appointed by the executive by the Brockton Housing Authority. Spoken with Tom Tebow to be that representative. And I think the establishment of this board will really provide a mechanism to supervise and oversee the development and continue to ensure that it's a contributing part of the community and looks out for the interests of the community. And finally, I just want to note, as Jay mentioned in his description, that the chapel will have significant community spaces. And as is typical in a lot of our developments, we make those spaces available for neighborhood organizations, city agencies. So really we can integrate the housing into the larger community. Because again, we see ourselves as being a long-term steward of this housing and a long-term participant and have an active presence within the community. So that concludes our formal presentation, and we'd be happy to answer any questions that any board members have, and I'll turn it back over to the chairman and to Rob.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And thanks to the presenting members there. I've got some questions myself. I'm part of the planning board. I'm sure the other members do as well. So I'll kick off my questions. How did you arrive at the number of 175 units? How did you arrive at that density criteria?
Sure.
Is it just a function of the size of the site? Is that?
Sure. I think that the 175 units is permitted within the 40R zoning overlay district. And I think as we look at the site in terms of what is, you know, an appropriate level of development given the size of the site and given appropriate density boundaries, that 175 really fit with, you know, what was an appropriate number for this location. I think given the given the internal infrastructure that's being provided, that level of housing is consistent and would be supportive of that infrastructure. So we looked at that very closely. We also, as part of this, we're committed to preserving the chapel itself, which is, you know, roughly about 39 units within the housing, and then planning and designing the balance of the units around that. But I think that's been a, you know, it's been a process that we've gone through since the original discussions around the 40R district. And I think that was identified and set as a reasonable, appropriate number given the size of the site.
All right, thank you. Next question for me is what is the total yield bedrooms? How many bedrooms in total does the 175 units yield?
So I don't know, Jay, if you, so I believe that the convent has 39 units. That as, let's see, most of those are one bedroom. So there's 32, about 30, I believe six or seven bedrooms within the convent. And then within the balance of the site, there's 136 units and it's about 256 bedrooms within the balance of the site. There's a mix, the balance of the site with 27 one bedrooms, 98 two bedrooms and 11 three bedrooms. And Jay can correct me if I got those numbers wrong.
So you have 21 one bedrooms, 98 two bedrooms and 11 three bedrooms.
It was 27 one bedrooms.
27, I'm sorry.
So those are in the non-convent portion, there's 136 units. There's 27 one bedrooms, 98 two bedrooms and 11 three bedrooms. And then within the convent itself, there's 39 units. And there are four studios, 32 one bedrooms, one two bedroom and one and two three bedrooms.
Okay, so that I'm sorry if I put you on the spot here. It sounds like I did, but so do you have a bottom line number, even approximately what the total site has for bedrooms?
Probably it's about 285, 290 bedrooms.
290 bedrooms. Okay, so where I'm going with this is, I heard you mention, so you've got 175 units yielding about 290 bedrooms, and you what was your the total of the number of parking spaces, sir?
185 parking spaces.
So in your calculation, I don't know if this is from the 40R regulations or your own projections. So you've got, I'm sorry, once again, please, on the parking spaces?
185 parking spaces.
185, so you feel as though that's adequate to support 290 bedrooms?
Yes, and I think there's a couple of elements that I would highlight in response to that question. First, you know, of the bedrooms, again, within the convent itself, we're projecting that that's going to be focused on senior housing, given the nature of that development. And typically on our senior housing developments, the actual usage of parking spaces is significantly less than one space per unit. And then also, you know, for the balance, you know, overall, you know, we went back and looked at our portfolio of properties, and on average, you know, we're providing about 0.75 spaces per unit. And the actual usage, as it turns out, is less than that, you know, on average about 0.65 spaces per unit. Here we're providing one space per unit, which is a little bit more than one space per unit, which is the minimum that's required by the 40R zoning district. So we believe that what we're providing is adequate given the, you know, given our experience in this type of development, given when we've gone back and looked at other properties and given the mix between senior and non-senior housing.
Okay, all right. Next question for me is, there's a public transportation component to this project. Can you just elaborate a little bit on the public transportation component as far as the round trips per day and so forth? You're utilizing the BAT bus system, I assume.
So yes, as we've designed this site in order to make that connection with public transportation, we've incorporated a bus stop and extension of the BAT route to be internal to the site and have designed it accordingly, based upon their requirements, and have had conversations with BAT around that. In terms of the actual usage, I don't know that we have specific usage numbers in terms of the bus route itself. I think as Jeff noted in his presentation, you know, we certainly expect that the vehicle usage will be reduced as we incorporate the bus route within the development.
Right. My question was more about if you know how many daily trips does the bus service make to your site?
I don't know the answer to that. You know, I think that we have to have further conversations with BAT to see what they would anticipate in terms of the number of services within the site.
Yes, because I would imagine that the more trips, the better. That would certainly ease the sure. Take the pressure off of individual vehicle use. But that would be an interesting number to learn. Question for the landscape architect: in listening to your presentation about your proposed landscape design, how mature are the trees going to be in your proposal? What is the maturity of the trees that you propose to plant on the site?
Yeah, thank you for that question. The trees would be 2.5 to 3 inch caliper is typical what we would use for the street trees. Some of the trees that would be placed within the interior, not along the street, would be of a smaller size. But that would be the approach.
I thank you for your answer. Was there any comment relative to the specifics of your selections on the part of, if there was, I didn't see it, I'm sorry. But was there any comment on the part of the peer review on your with your size, with the matter of size of your selection of your plantings?
There was not a comment on that issue. The plans that were submitted were conceptual in nature, and we had a recommended plant list that we would be using as we advance the landscape design. So we didn't get into specifics on tree size. We did have a discussion about some of the plantings that would be used in the stormwater areas in particular, but nothing specific. About
the caliper of the trees. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, yes, I do have an answer on the buses. The current BAT schedule, which is reduced because of COVID, is running 23 buses per day. At the peak hours, they're running a bus every 30 minutes.
Well, on Thatcher Street, Mr. May?
Thatcher through down Crescent Street.
Wow, that's in excess of what I had imagined. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. May.
You're welcome.
One or two more questions from me, and I'll turn it over to the other board members. On the matter of elevators, the existing buildings without elevators, how many stories is the soon to be converted convent? Is that a two-story building?
Convent is a three-story building, okay, and does have an elevator.
And it does have an elevator.
Yes.
So which of the, I'm sorry to make you repeat yourself, but which of the buildings that are proposed to operate without the benefit of an elevator?
Only the B buildings, B1 and B2.
And how many stories are they, sir?
They're three also. But the way those buildings work is on the ground floor, there's a flat unit, which is a single level unit. Direct entrance from the exterior. And then the two upper floors are two level units. So you'll go upstairs to a living and dining level. And then once you're in that level, you go upstairs to the bedrooms for that unit.
All right, well, thank you. Okay, I guess my other question was answered. I had a question about but I guess it was answered by the traffic engineer. I did have a question about the impacts of those peak traffic trips, but I guess he answered that. Okay, so at this time, I'll turn the comments over or invite comments from the other board members. Any of the planning board members have comments or questions or concerns at this time, please?
Mr. Chair, this is Larry.
Larry, good evening, yes.
How are you? Good. Question on the BAT bus location, which the terminal is going to be within the site. It looks like it's at building B2, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And with that, is there any kind of an agreement or something in process with Brockton Area Transit to actually have that happen? Or is this something that is just a proposal right now? Because I'm not clear on whether that's actually going to happen or not.
We've had have several conversations with Mike Lambert at BAT about incorporating that. I believe that he was preparing and sending a letter to the city confirming their interest in doing that. So you know, so we have a letter. I've had significant conversations, and they've indicated an interest in relocating the. A bus stop to that location would be providing a covered covered area as well for individuals to utilize, and we work to address and incorporate the design, the access and accommodations within the site to meet their needs.
Okay, thank you for that. On the affordable units part, how many are classified as affordable? How does that work? I'm not clear on how many units will be considered affordable units. Is there a number or a percentage?
So I think under the 40R district, the 40R district requires, I believe it's 25% of the units to be affordable at households who are earning less than 80% of area median income. I think we've indicated that we would, that's sort of the minimum requirement within the 40R district. We've indicated that, given, the importance of providing, a diversity of households, diversity of housing for household incomes, that we would be committing to at least, 51% or 88 of the units to be affordable to households earning less than 80%. Our goal is really to provide a mixed income development that, provides a diversity of housing types. The ultimate mix will depend upon the financial feasibility of the development, but we're committing to providing at least, 50% that are, 51% that are affordable to households earning less than 80% of area median income. Just as a point of context, our approach, across our developments is to provide, mixed income housing, and a part of that is having, unrestricted, market housing as part of the development. We expect that here that there would be at least a third of the units that would fall into that category, because we feel that that's reflective of the community as a whole, and that's the best way to provide, diverse. Integrated development. So we're committing to it, at least 51% below 80%. There'll be a significant percentage that are unrestricted, but the ultimate mix will depend upon the financial feasibility as we get into our financing applications.
Okay. And I did hear, and I'm just looking for it because I was writing notes. I got notes all over the place, so excuse me. Are some of these affordable units or designated for people that work in the city? And you had mentioned something about Massasoit. I know it was in here somewhere, but is that part of that percentage too as well?
Yeah, so we're proposing to provide a local preference for of up to 70%, to the maximum that's permitted by law, which is up to 70% of the units would be set aside for a local preference. And I think there's typically, several categories for households, individuals to fall within that local preference. One of them is, current residents within the city of Brockton. Another one is municipal employees. Third one is employees of local businesses, which would include Massasoit Community College. And then fourth is households with children who are already in the city's city school system. So that would be across all of the units to provide that type of a preference. And we'd be working with the city to actively market and to advertise for that so that we can really make this a community and a city asset and make these housing units available for city residents who fall into those different categories.
Okay, thank you for that answer. And just one last question, because I'm thinking out loud as you're presenting the information, and I appreciate your answers and your time. In your experience in other cities and towns, how has the reception been with the local people with that work in the city, or, you know, get that special preference? Has it been pretty receptive? Yeah. Like, say somebody works for, you know, the city of Brockton, and, you know, they want to go in and rent that apartment. How's that been in other cities and towns?
Yeah, and it's a great question. It's something that that we frankly feel very strongly about. And, you know, for example, up in Haverhill, we did a, you know, development that had a, you know, similar type of a local preference. We worked closely with the city of Haverhill, with the city government, city officials, to market it to employees, to market it within, you know, to, you know, school teachers who were within the district. And we're very successful in, you know, hitting the percentages that we were trying to, you know, that we committed to. So part of it is, you know, working together with the city in terms of outreach, in terms of making sure people are aware of the housing opportunities, and making sure that notice, marketing, education gets out there, encouraging people to apply. Because again, this is a, you know, preference. You know, and our goal is to have 70% of the units occupied by households who fall within that. But it does require effort to make sure that outreach is being made to, you know, all of the potential households who could fit within that preference.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Let's see. Okay, very good. I Rob, thank you. Yeah, if I can sneak in one more question, Mr. Grogan. We hear these terms, to me, they're a bit abstract. You'll hear the term affordable housing, market rate, and so forth. If you can, approximately, can you express in dollars per month for rent, what is the difference, a comparable unit, between affordable and market rate? You pick a unit, let's say a typical, what do you have most of here? You've got mostly, what is it? Two bedroom. Okay, so take an average two bedroom. What's the comparison in actual dollars month rent per rate for those two differences?
Yep, no, it's a great question, and I think it's important to, you know, provide that, you know, that type of a context. So, you know, at 80% income level for a two bedroom unit, the, you know, the rent would be $1,700, I believe it's about $1,713. So a little over $1,700 for a two bedroom unit at an 80% limit. And for a household, you know, for a household that's a, you know, two person household earning about a little over $60,000, you know, a three person household earning a little bit over $68,000.
Okay, so that's okay. That's the clarification. That $1,700, and then what if you didn't qualify for those benefits? What would be what I would call a market rate rent?
So market rent would be. I don't have the, you know, market study in front of me right now, but, you know, my guess is that's probably certainly in the, you know, low 2000, you know, above $2,000, you know, for a two bedroom unit. I'd have to, again, I don't have the market study with me right now.
I just wanted to get an idea because we hear these terms used so much, sure. Affordable housing and market rate. And then when they're expressed in dollars per month for rent, the spread isn't really that much. Just to point, just my, sure. My own interest, I guess, but it's, you know, it just puts numbers to, it puts numbers to phrases is what it does.
Yeah. And thank you. I think it's a good way to put some, again, put some context around those percentages.
Yes. To me, it does. Thank you, sir. Thanks for that response. So do any of the other board members have any questions, concerns, comments at this time?
I do. I just have a question.
Certainly.
So you said 290 bedrooms, so let's round it off, say 300 lives in this very big community. And I didn't hear anything reference to outdoor recreation like basketball courts or kickball, place to kick a ball around, playgrounds. Did I miss that piece, or do you want
to? That actually is a good question, Tony. That was one of the comments. That was one of the still one of the comments that was made by Beta. That's was going to be, I guess, maybe in the next round was going to be some issues that we have yet to that they have yet to address. It's an excellent question, and they can feel free to respond to it. But that was one of the, I don't know if you got a chance to read Beta's most recent response, but that was one of the things that still needs to be resolved. But would someone like to handle that one?
Sure. Yeah, I can address that. I think we're committed to, you know, providing an appropriate, you know, play area, playground area, either, you know, on site. I think there's a shown on the site plan, there's a significant open space towards the rear of the site that's currently being highlighted would be a location. We've also had discussions with the city about possibly making a contribution to upgrade, playground area offsite. So I think we're open to, you know, one of those two approaches, depending upon what serves the community's needs the best.
I just think with, you know, that many lives, it's going to bring added value to this community right here. They're going to need a place to get out in more than just a playground. It's going to need other recreation space.
And again, we're open to that either within the site or offsite, depending upon what the community's preference is. But certainly agree with that comment, and we're committed to providing it.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, Larry again. Just to piggyback on that, I mean, I was going through some of the notes that were provided, and I see there is two common spaces that have been noted on the plan. One is a park at park, and then there's an area of just an open space, mown lawn area, play yard. Those are some of the areas that you're considering for those? I mean, I assume that's what that is.
Yeah. Yes. I think in along Thatcher Street, we've identified some open space areas where, again, you know, probably not having a play area up in that location, given the proximity to Thatcher Street. But we've identified those as, you know, including some, you know, walking trails. We've having a memorial to the sisters as well within that area. But there would be some landscaped. Benches, sitting areas, so that could become an active landscaped area. But I think with respect to, you know, potential, you know, playground area within the site, we would look to have that be more internal to the site. And again, likely to the rear of the site.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions or concerns or comments on the part of the board? All right, we can come back to that. If you think of any, please make some notes, and I mean we can address any questions that you might have. This being a public hearing, at this time, we will open this up. Mr. May, is this an appropriate time to open up to a public comment?
Yes, it is, Mr. Chairman. And to start the public comment, if I may. We received a letter earlier today from Jeannie Holmes of Brockton, and we made that letter available to all the board members. It's also on our website in the Thatcher Street folder. But if I may summarize, she would like to see a traffic study done. And as you heard this evening, there was a traffic study. She would also like for there to be an analysis of the impact to the wetlands, which, as you heard earlier, there has been. And amongst other issues, she would like to see a lower number of units. But in general, you can find her comments up on, you have your copies of that. And so, I'll open it up to other folks who have questions. I see one attendee with a raised hand, and I am going to...
There are three.
I've got several, quite a few, but I'm going to open up and allow Barbara
Mr. May, if I may suggest.
Yes, sir.
When you're entertaining questions, we would like to keep the repetition to an absolute minimum. It has the potential of being a long hearing, and we certainly want to listen to everybody's concern, but repetitive comments should be discouraged, I would expect.
Okay. Barbara, you now have permission to talk. If you could give us your name and address, and then you may address the board.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Barbara Owens. I live at 222 Thatcher Street, directly across from the proposed building. So I have three children with autism, and my concern is more for C1 than any of the other buildings. I'm concerned about the elevator side building and the amount of noise, because that's the closest one that's to my house. Also, I'm concerned about the traffic. I heard mention about the bus on Thatcher Street. The bus that goes on Thatcher Street is a nonstop bus and doesn't make any current stops on Thatcher Street. I had typed in a question regarding whether or not this proposal is going to now have stops on Thatcher Street itself. Also, Thatcher Street is a very busy street and people generally speed there. If this complex is going to come here with about 185 parking spaces inside, what would happen with the additional parking where when you have more than two people in a household driving a vehicle? Where would they park, and what would that do for the traffic on Thatcher Street itself? Will there be sidewalks on Thatcher Street for people who are not part of the complex? I had mentioned about the sidewalks within the complex, but I didn't hear anything mentioned about the parts of Thatcher Street that does not currently have sidewalks, where now you would have to be on it because you would not be able to walk in the street like we're currently doing. So I have concerns about the noise that's happening because my kids are very sensitive to that. And with the addition of this particular building being so close to where I live, I have concerns with that. I moved from Boston because of my children's disability to come here in a very quiet space. And the news of this for the past 2 years or so with all the meetings that's been going on really frightens me at this point in terms of the noise. And my only other piece had to do with the community center, having a community center within that complex for the people and the children who might be living there.
What is your questions relative to the community center? I'm sorry.
If you're gonna have 175 units, mixed income, some of it, 25% is gonna be low income. To me, that means that you're gonna have families, you're gonna have people with children, small children living there. And so with a number of small children living there, we have no playground here. The safety piece is, where would they go? Would they go to Massasoit to play? They would have to have a place to play and to keep them sort of like within there and not out on the street. So that's a safety concern for me.
Okay. Does that finish your questions, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I have one question for you. Can you roughly approximate where your house is relative to building C1, please? Where are you?
So I am on the opposite. So C1 is directly opposite from the adult day center. And I'm the building that's right next to it. So the sisters originally owned the property that my house is on, and they sold it years ago.
Oh, I see.
Ms. Owen, can I jump in for just a second?
Sure.
Bob, if you're looking at the diagram that's up in front of you now, where you see C1,
yes.
You'll to the left of that, you see the entrance and exit arrows?
Yes.
Directly above that is Ms. Owen's home.
That's me. That's me.
Oh, that's you. Okay, so you are close. All right. Okay, so thank you for your questions. If you're assuming that you're done, ma'am, thank you.
Yes, sir.
So is there someone in the team, maybe the architect, that could respond just quickly, briefly, to a question of a concern of noise emanating out of C1?
Is the question or the concern for noise during construction or noise in the finished condition?
Well, maybe both, but I would imagine going forward.
Finished condition.
When it's operating, fully up and operating.
Yeah, so I wouldn't anticipate any extraordinary noise from 28 residential units. I think there's no exterior space associated with that building, so it's not like there would be people outside at a basketball court or something like that that would cause noise. So I don't see any real concern with that in the finished condition.
Does a question for you, sir? Does the as building codes increase, which increases the need for wall insulation, is that also, is there a benefit to sound deadening with that as well?
There certainly would be, but again, I wouldn't expect to hear people within their units outside on the street unless something is going on that shouldn't be going on.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Certainly not at that distance. Thank you, sir.
No.
I think her other question was, is there an improved sidewalk on Thatcher, or do you plan to put an improved sidewalk on Thatcher on your side, was the question. Is there already an existing sidewalk there now?
I believe there is. We were adding sidewalk on this side of the site, but Brian, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure sidewalk exists in this location.
All right, thank you. And Mr. May, I apologize. What was Barbara's other, did that cover?
The other question was regarding the bat bus, and will the bat bus be stopping?
You've explained that you've made provisions with bat to come inside the site, but I believe the lady's question was, will this amount to some stops along Thatcher Street as well? Do you know that?
And the answer to that is it will probably not. The proposal that we've been discussing with BAT is to have the bus come out of Massasoit Drive, which is on the dog leg of Thatcher. So it's on the right-hand side of the drawing that you see here. It would then enter the property around C1, come through the site, and then exit the building next to building A, and then come back to Massasoit Boulevard.
Okay, I think that responded to all of her concerns. I believe it did.
Let me see who is next. Aileen, I'm going to unmute you, Elaine, I'm sorry, forgive me. But please give us your name and first and last name and your address.
Hi, my name is Elaine Donovan. I live at 42 Thatcher Square. Thank you for taking my questions. I just want to say, I'll try and be brief. I have some questions or comments regarding the traffic study and the parking. Up front, I probably should say that I would have preferred that this be not a high density 40R zoning and keep it single family, but dealing with the project at hand. The traffic study meant, well, first of all, can everyone hear me? I want to make sure my mic.
Yes, okay, go ahead, great, please. Yeah.
So the traffic study was mentioned that it studied from Pine Street to, it studied Thatcher Street from Pine Street to the entrance to the college. That, in my opinion, seems extremely limited zone to do the traffic study because there are no major intersections. And I would have thought a more relevant study would have included where all this traffic from Thatcher, which joins up with Pine, which then joins up to Summer Street, it spills out onto Grove Street and Crescent Street. And also if you go down Pine, it spills onto Crescent Street. So I feel like that traffic study seemed extremely limited and ignored some of the real, high density traffic intersections. There are no major intersections. The only thing between Pine and Massasoit are side streets.
Okay, well, did you have any other, we'll give the professionals an opportunity to respond to that, ma'am. Did you have any other questions?
I do have other comments, and that's right, regarding. Well,
then why don't we let the traffic engineer, since he's on the call, briefly respond to your question or concern. Was the traffic study expansive enough to satisfy the concerns of the site?
Correct.
Is the traffic engineer there, please? Is he still on the call? Did we lose him?
I don't see him on the call. It looks like he may.
In lieu of that, is the representative from Beta on the call?
Yes, I am here.
Okay, I'll explain to, I think it's Elaine. I'm sorry, I don't have your last name.
Donovan.
A project like this, a community relies on outside peer review, as a lot of communities do. In this case, the city reached out to a firm known as Beta Group, and part of their review process was to review the traffic study. So in the absence of the traffic engineer, I saw your firm's comments on some traffic concerns. So could you address that, sir?
Sure. My name is Phil Paradis with Beta Group. I'm the project manager for this review. We've had our traffic group look at this pretty thoroughly. We do a number of these traffic analyses ourselves. The project generally meets the requirements of a traffic impact analysis for this type of project. I think the concern is, as we concur with Mr. Dirk's comments made earlier this evening, the distribution of the traffic, as he mentioned, is going to spread out pretty quickly relative to the local network, and the intersections that were closest to the project were analyzed, and it was shown that they would not change in their level of service. There wouldn't be an excessive delay as a result of this project.
Okay, well, if I may, I'm not sure what intersections that is being considered closest to the project, because there are no major intersections. There's only side streets in that limited expanse that was studied. And it's a unique area down here where you have Thatcher, joins up with Pine, joins up with Summer, and these all spill out into what I would consider the real intersections, which is that from Summer, Grove Street, Crescent Street, and then Pine is basically a one-way and it goes down, comes out onto Crescent near Electric Ave, and those intersections are already very congested, and it just concerns me that the traffic was only studied between Pine and Massasoit on Thatcher, because that's a very narrow zone without any real major intersections, and it doesn't, all this area spills onto that, okay, you know, traffic cluster.
I think he gets the, so her concern, sir, is was the traffic study done by the traffic engineer, was it broad enough or expansive enough to cover the possible impacts or concerns of the project?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
If we might, obviously this project is not going to be decided tonight.
Nope.
There are outstanding issues and some considerable testimony. But I would like to have Van Ness and the applicant and Beta, if we could schedule a meeting for early next week to discuss this particular traffic issue. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Thank you for suggesting that, Mr. May.
Yep, that's
thank you, Elaine.
Thank you very much. Can I make my one other question comment, please?
Please, real quickly, please.
I think that I would just want to point out that I think the the impact of the bat bus as mitigating any parking and traffic concerns is being greatly exaggerated. I feel like the estimation that the usage of the parking spaces will only be 0.65 or 0.75 per unit seems really small. And I heard that's based on other properties. I think many of those other properties are probably in the city of Boston. And I just want to point out that nobody that lives in Brockton is going to decide that they can ditch their car because they live 100 yards away from a BAT bus stop. It's a great service for the elderly or people who can't own a car or drive for whatever reason, but I don't think it should be considered as something that's actually going to make impact someone's decision to not have or own or drive their own vehicle just because the BAT bus is going to go through the site. It's not like the impact that the T has if you're living in the middle of the city. It's just not the same out here, and I believe the members of the planning board will agree with me. So thank you. I think the project is too big and too dense. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I am going
Let me just conclude.
Oh, sorry, sir.
I'm sorry.
Sorry, go ahead.
I just want to interject a fast comment to Elaine's comment. And the board has those same concerns, ma'am. 175 units, 290 bedrooms. And we have the same concerns, and that's why we're relying rather heavily on the peer review group Beta to give us the necessary analysis and response to the project. But our concerns are similar to yours, but thank you to your questions. Mr. May?
Mr. Chairman, there is a person on the phone, 508-942-1678. I am unmuting you. If you could please introduce yourself and give us your address, please. And hopefully I have unmuted you.
You don't look unmuted.
Well, I've unmuted, but...
He's got his hand up.
There they go.
Hello?
There they go.
Hello?
Hello. Yes. Please Jean identify Holmes. Yourself.
Jean Holmes Carell, 65 Belcher Ave. And I appreciate the fact that, Mr. May, you mentioned that I had submitted matters, but I really had expected that it would be read not just to the board, but to everyone. So let me start out by saying that I come to you today and ask you to be honorable men and be men of your words. As you all know, there has been and continues to be no community support for this Thatcher Street project by the Catholic Church developer and the nuns. As evidence of this, I remind you of the history of the 40R process relating to that property. And I hereby incorporate all of the letters that you have received at the various minutes of these meetings as it relates to this project as it has come along. I also remind you all of the meeting on December 5th, 2017, when about 50 residents came to the building, sat with you face to face, eyeball to eyeball, and you were impressed by them to the extent that you as the planning board at that time did not recommend this proposal, did not represent this project. Now, Mr. May, during those meetings said, oh, this is not the project. We're just talking about the 40R. But that
excuse
was a
me, Mr. Chairman. I'm
park.
Sorry. I'm sorry. Excuse me. One second, ma'am. Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I believe this is the letter that was addressed to the planning board that we have to read. So I don't think that we.
I want the people. This is a public hearing. I want the other people who can't read it to be able to hear this tonight. Thank
please,
you.
Please address.
And I will continue. I will continue. As I said, on December 5th. Of 2017,
Mr. Chair, can you, please
you all recommended that this not be going forward. You subsequently recommended it unfavorably to the city council. As we know, it went forward in any regard. But at each of one of these processes, you told the residents that they would have the opportunity to have input into minimizing the destruction of this project to our fair city. And I don't know if anybody from Beta Goat is from here or knows our city, but you've heard from a couple of people already. And I urge you to remember all of those faces, those 50 people that filled the basement floor and the 75 people that came and spoke out in opposition, and not one single person spoke in favor of it. So I ask you all, as you go forward on this, to remember those people, those faces, because nobody's changed their mind. Okay. It has only gained the amount of non-support by way of this rolling ball. So let me get to the more particulars of this, because I ask you, we're here, the ordinance is here, and we're stuck with it. But you, the planning board, men of your word, I ask you to be so, and to make sure that as you look at this plan, you address the issues, and not just in terms of a question by a person and then an answer from the proposers, but that you confine this project as you can. Use every bit of your authority, your power that is invested with you, even staying within the confines of this ordinance, to make this project as livable and as acceptable as it is to swallow this huge, humongous boulder that we have got to swallow here in the city of Brockton. So I know that people want me to move along, and I will do so. As I sent to Mr. May, and he read a couple of things, the first two things, and I just want to make sure, am I still on?
Yes, but if I may interject, Ms. Holmes, we're in receipt of your cover letter and your, what is it, your 18 point request.
Yes. But I wanted it read. I wanted it read, so I would like to go through a couple of these.
If I may, in the interest of time, we just received this letter yesterday. It would appear as though, given that fact and given the fact that it's probably likely not going to be approved this evening, in other words, this is going to get likely, I can't speak for the board, but it would seem reasonable that it's going to get continued to another meeting. Anybody that would like to read your cover letter or read the comments, your list of comments, can feel free to go to the public website and read it word for word for word. There is no need or no benefit for your reading it sentence by sentence.
I'm going to get to my point now. So I'm hearing tonight, okay, and this is additional stuff. So, I mean, I think the most important thing, and you, Mr. Pelagi, have said it, that this is too big, and you have the power and authority to reduce the number of units. I have suggested 75. I think that is something that is certainly workable, and at least a bigger pill to swallow for the residents. I also note to you that the ordinance only requires 20% to be affordable housing, and you have the ability, again, to put conditions on it. But these conditions have to be firm, and I urge you to be firm in setting your conditions. For example, about the bat bus stuff, I ask you to make these all conditions before they can go forward. A condition that there be a commitment to the bat bus terminal, a commitment that there be a condition to all of these promises that they have made to you and before this project is approved. Because as we know, things can be said, we're going to try to do this, we're going to try to do that. It needs to be required by you, and you all have the authority to do so, even within 40R to do so. So I do urge you to put caps on the number of affordable houses, reduce the number of units, make them put forth the actual commitments, make them commit to the types of trees that they're going to do that was brought up earlier today that I had not thought of, and I appreciate that being brought forward. But I ask that these be required conditions that, as Mr. May said at the beginning of this meeting, you can require. So I understand this is not going to end tonight, but I do ask you to really nail this down. You have the ability to be the men of your word and the woman of your word. When you said to people, even though this went through, we know, we hear you, and we will make sure that you have say in making this a more palatable situation. What is proposed now is out of control, and you have the ability to rein it in following the law of the ordinance that is in place. I ask you, I urge you, I beg you on behalf of myself and the hundreds of people that are not able to be in front of you face to face for you to see our faces and to remember our pain. Please make sure you do this well, do it right, and give us the word that you gave us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And while this is fresh here, does Beta Group have a copy of her list of concerns? I think I should have asked her while she was on. I don't know if she still is. I'm not sure that she's representing just herself or the particular neighborhood there, but does Beta Group have a copy of this, and does the developer have a copy of her comments?
The developer has a copy of her comments, yes.
Yes, we do.
And does Beta Group have a copy?
I have not seen it yet, right.
I did not send them to Beta Group.
No. Unless there's an issue in doing so, I highly recommend you do. Just to say that we've covered her concerns. She's got a two-page cover letter and two pages of recommendations. So I would ask the representative from Beta Group to review those. Is there anybody else on, Rob, that you recognize?
Yes. Next up is Mr. Bob Farrell. I'm going to unmute you. There you should be able to talk. Bob, if you're there, you are.
Farrell. Bob Farrell, 149 Carl Ave in Brockton. And I was going through some of the drawings that were presented on the package, which I went through tonight, and they are no longer there. My concern was with the traffic flow, your drawings AT1, AT2, 3 and 4, which are the bus routes going through and the fire apparatus going through. I noticed on AT4, when they come in and if they the ladder trucks have to enter on the rear side of the property, there is no approach lane or probable approach lane made on that. And the other thing on your entrance and exits going out onto Thatcher Street, those are awful close to the Massasoit side of the curb. And if you look at one, The red line, which designates the chassis, actually overhangs or touches the curb there. And my other comment that I noticed tonight on AT2, where your proposed bus stop, there seems to be a bump out on that curb. And if I am assuming the intentions of this drawing, the bus will actually move in towards your proposed shelter. And then they're being blocked by the curb. So it looks like they have to drive over the curb to make that left-hand turn. Other than that, those are the two drawings, the things that I noted on the drawings. But I do have questions on the effect on Brockton Public Schools. We've heard that there's a lot of bedrooms coming in. Bedrooms are filled with children. And as you know, Brockton Public Schools have been underfunded by the state, and we've picked up the papers many times in the past year, and the funding is not coming. So you do have a problem. You also have school bus traffic to concern.
Excuse me, Mr. Farrell. Mr. May, would it be appropriate for you to, if you feel comfortable doing so, to respond to his concern about the impact on the school?
Yes, sir. Just as we have been told by the superintendent of schools, Mike Thomas, the school population, school enrollment has dropped citywide and is projected to continue to drop for some time. These are not huge drops, of course, but they are going down. That has, as a matter of fact, caused some financial concerns for the school department because 80% of our funding comes from the state. The city of Brockton's taxpayers only pay for 20% of that educational cost. As we lose students, we lose money. So the superintendent was not concerned about adding more people to the school district. I'm not talking about this project in particular, but in general, the need to keep up the school age population.
Thank you, Mr. May. And as far as his concern about the school bus routing, is that something that we would need to respond to, or would the
school department will figure that out?
Okay. Do you have any?
Bob alluded to, there are drawings on the website that show the turning radius for fire apparatus and bat buses. The school bus should have the same turning radii. We will work with the designer and the traffic engineer in between these meetings to try to clear that up for you guys.
Does that respond to your concerns, Mr. Farrell?
Yes, it does. But like I said, the turns onto the downhill side of Massasoit for the fire apparatus seem tight. And like okay, I said,
all right, give the proponent an opportunity to respond to that. I think he had some auto turn drawings on there showing the clearances and radiuses, but give them a chance to respond to that. Thank you.
Okay, fine. One last traffic issue, and I know it's a dead horse that's been beat. These traffic studies, again, are probably out of date due to COVID and everything else. But
he responded to that. His opening statement from the traffic engineer, I believe, was that these were done with traffic flows that preceded the impact of the coronavirus.
Yes, but that was not what I was going to say. I was going to say what they also are not figuring in is the traffic that has been rerouted through mapping services from Route 18 because of the construction. So that has also been picked up. That traffic is also picked up. They're also not considering the junkyard traffic that goes up. And junk right now is $209 a ton. So you have additional traffic on that road. Plus, they're not also allowing for the construction vehicles that are going to be going into the site delivering construction materials for this build.
Okay.
So with that, I think I'll call it a night, but I thank you for your time and appreciation. And I do appreciate, believe it or not, the traffic study, because I did read it and it did look rather involved. But I will say my father-in-law, who's not around anymore, lived at 186 Thatcher Street. I was up there twice a day. And I invite anyone to try to back out of their driveway when Massasoit is in session. That's all I'm going to say, and thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Tom Martin, you are up next. I'm allowing you. You are unmuted now, Tom. Or you can unmute yourself. There you go.
Hi, this is Heather Martin.
Oh, sneaky.
My husband, Tom Martin. But I agree with everyone that's spoken tonight, all my neighbors.
Excuse me, Heather, can we get your address?
Oh, sorry, Heather Martin, 15 Beaver Street, Brockton. Our street is right across from the St. Joseph's Manor Nursing Home.
All right, thank you.
And we are right, and Barbara Owens, actually, we are right behind her house.
Mm-hmm.
So this, I don't like the whole idea, but it's not, I guess I can't really do anything about that. One of my biggest concerns is, again, the traffic, because all the side streets off of Thatcher Street are used as cut-throughs to get through to this the elementary school down there, Downey Elementary, and then to get to Crescent Street where all the, you know, Shaw's and Home Depot is. And how is that? I mean, how are you addressing that? Was that included in the study, the traffic study?
Is the representative still on, Rob?
We'll take that question under advisement and we can report back on that.
All right,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, the representative's not here.
Okay,
he had a connection issue, so he has not been able to stay on, but we'll take that question as well as all the other ones under advisement and report.
That's a big concern because, like I said, it's used as a cut through all the side streets going down Thatcher Street. There's tons of kids on my street. There's tons of kids over on Lafoy and George Street. And it's used as a cut through now.
Okay, really well, the applicant has stated that he's going to take that under advisement and have a response for it. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Rob?
Thank you. Next, I have a Galaxy S10 calling. I don't know your name, but I'm unmuting you. Whoops, where'd you go? Oh, there you are. I think you're unmuted.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh. The engineer's bad.
It looks like Jeffrey Dirk. Jeff Dirk is in the attendee list.
Yeah, I can see. Oh, I just lost him again.
Am I unmuted?
Yeah. Galaxy S10, yes. Who are you? Could you give us your name and where you live?
Sure, it's Arlene Morocco, and I live on 80 Kane Street, Brockton.
Yeah.
And I just had one question. It's actually about the traffic. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. We live on Kane Street. It's the first left coming down. You know, we're like right behind the first street on the left. If you left the project, the development. And we're just worried about the traffic on that street because the last call, she made a point about cut-throughs, and our street is bad enough right now with people cutting through to go to the college. So I'm just wondering what's going to happen when this is built. Even if they did a traffic study now, you're not going to be able to tell once this is built with over 300 cars coming down side streets. So I just had a concern about the traffic on my street, which is right across from Lafoy.
All right. Lots of questions to the applicant. Lots of questions and concerns about traffic.
Correct.
And again, we'll take those under advisement and we can report back.
Thank you, sir.
This is Jeffrey Dirk. I'm back on. I apologize. I have been listening, so I apologize. Our cable's out and it's not going to get back on until 11. So, but I am available by phone. I have heard all of the comments, with the exception of the woman who was speaking when I dropped off. So I'm happy to answer those now, or I can wait, Mr. Chairman, because I apologize for losing the connection.
And again, Mr. Dirk, you are the representative from Vanessa?
I am, yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Well, I mean, if you...
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I would suggest, since we have a large chunk of traffic issues and some other civil engineering and traffic that we need to address, we do this and have a written response at the at our next meeting.
That responds to all of them.
So let's try to generate the questions.
Yeah.
Now.
Okay, I agree. And you're going to stay on the call, Mr. Dirk?
I am. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Well, was that Valerie on the Galaxy S10?
No, Darlene.
I'm sorry. Please forgive me.
That's okay. Yeah, I was just wondering about the traffic study. I mean, how could you do it now when 300 cars are going to all of a sudden start coming through here? It's just going to get way, way worse.
Well, I mean, that's something, I'm not a traffic engineer, but they factor that in, you know, pre and post construction. That's one of the things they do, and they project the traffic now and the impacts of the traffic after the project is done. I mean, I don't mean to speak to the traffic engineer, but I would imagine that's part of the concept.
Well, how do they know how much traffic's going to come down my street?
Again, what street are you?
K Kame Street, right across from LaFoy?
Well, again, that question has already been answered in the general way, asked in the general way, ma'am, in that we're going to give the developer a chance to respond to the question, was the study big enough or expansive enough to take in all of these neighborhoods' side street concerns? So we're going to give them a chance to respond to that, and that'll come up at the next meeting, I would imagine.
Okay, and one last thing, if the street gets too bad, we like a couple of speed bumps on our street, because like I said, they cut through this street to get to the college all the time, and it's getting out of control.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for your comment.
Thank you.
Tom had his hand up, but he put his hand down. Tom Martin, would you still like to make a statement? Tom Martin?
I believe Tom Martin was Heather Martin, if you already spoke.
Oh, that is right. I'm sorry. Can't tell the players without a scorecard. I don't have anybody else with their hands up right now. I do have additional questions from Barbara Owens, who have used the Q&A function. She would like to know, how long do you expect construction to last once you start?
Sure, we would anticipate construction to be 18 to 24 month time frame.
Okay. Mr. Grogan, this is not a phased project, is it? You're going to start and stay going until you finish?
Yeah, so just and maybe I can just speak to a little bit of time frame, Chairman, if that's
please do.
So, you know, our goal is, as we move forward, is to hopefully we're successful in arriving at an acceptable site design with the city and the planning board, and then to move to start to prepare applications for our financing, and that would include application to the State Department of Housing and Community Development. We would be spending the next 6 to 9 months to prepare construction pricing, financing applications, and to start that process. That process does take, involve application rounds with the state. The next one is, end of this year, January of next year is the first time that we could apply for financing. And it is typical that, the state does not approve projects the first time they come in. While we'd be hopeful to be funded in the first time around, it typically takes a couple of applications to receive funding from the state as a reviewer project. So that would mean that we're probably wouldn't be looking at starting construction for a couple of years out, given that time frame, and then we would be looking at doing the project. Again, the construction is roughly in 18 to 24 month time frame. Depending upon financing, it may be a phased construction, but but that would depend upon the financing sources and that come in from the state as well as our other lenders.
Elaine has another question. I'm sorry. Well, statement, she is hoping that we save the mature trees that are bordering on Thatcher. And I know that you had mentioned in the proposal that you're trying to save as many as possible. So we appreciate that. On the landscape plan, I believe you show the trees that are being saved versus the trees that are being, and what the new trees are. So that is available online. But in your next presentation, if you could put that slide up so that people can see what is being saved.
Yes, we'll certainly highlight that.
Lisa has made a statement about hiring extra police officers and firefighters. The city is always hiring, it seems like we're always hiring police and fire fighters. But I don't think we anticipate the need, a disproportionate need of new police and fire because of this site. She also asks about the proposed Massasoit property. Is a traffic study included in that project? And I'm not quite sure what she means by the proposed Massasoit property. And then, Lisa, if you could give us some, 500 apartments. I don't know where that, I do not know a proposal, Lisa, for 500 apartments. And then Ms. Owens also talked more about the sidewalk. There's there is no sidewalk at 222 Thatcher Street, which I believe is the opposite side of the street from your project, and the sidewalk currently ends at 250 Thatcher. So that's something that we need to take a look at, please.
Okay.
And I just had another hand go up. Okay. Jamal, you are open. Jamal, you may unmute your microphone and speak. He does not seem to. And Barbara Owens has one more question, if the board doesn't mind. And Barbara, you are unmuted now.
Hello again. So my question is regarding the mixed income, the 25% low income. I believe he said the two bedroom was going to be about 1700 for a two bedroom.
He's just ballparking or approximating.
Okay, so this is Brockton, and incomes here aren't matching up with the 17. I don't see how the 17 could be considered to be low income.
Because I'll let him answer, but I think I know the answer. But Mr. Grogan, you could. Sure.
Yeah, I'm happy to address that. That income tier under the 40R, it requires a minimum of 25% of the units to be affordable to households earning less than 80% of median income. And that $1,713 number is the maximum rent for an 80% household for a two bedroom unit. You know, I think that, you know, and so we are certainly committing to having, as I mentioned before, 51% of the units be affordable, you know, to households earning at or less than that. Again, our approach is to have a diversity of income types within the development. So there would be various income tiers, below 80%, as well as income tiers above 80%, to have a mixed income community.
Will families who have Section 8 certificates be able to apply?
Yes, you cannot discriminate against families that have Section 8 certificates. So anyone who has one is certainly entitled to apply, as they are to any other household in the city or across the Commonwealth.
Thank you.
Lastly, we would like to recognize our two counselors. I see Counselor Thompson had raised his hand first, and then Counselor Nicastro would like to bat cleanup, and this is her ward. So I look forward to Counselor Thompson. I believe you're unmuted.
Thank you, Rob, thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board, and Mr. Grogan and your team. I'd like to thank all the participants in this evening's Planning Board meeting. Although I am new to this project, I have been working closely with Councilor Nicastro, Representative Dubois, Mr. Grogan and his team to ensure that this development is responsive to the city's feedback and our concerns. And thankfully, they have been. Mr. Brogan and his team have listened to our feedback and have re-engineered their plan to address some of our concerns, including the overall footprint of this development, the building sight lines from Thatcher Street, and including a Brockton resident preference. Now, I understand my constituents' objections to this project being granted a 40R designation, and I share their traffic concerns. That's why the City Council has set aside $100,000 to help mitigate the impact of this development in the surrounding neighborhoods. And I plan to work with my constituents in these neighborhoods to identify and address any adverse impact that this development sets out. So thank you for that, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Mr. Brogan. That's all I have.
Councilor Nicastro.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It was a very good presentation and the project has come a long way. I'm gonna give you some issues that I have, and a lot of them are based off my notes from when we all met on September 23rd about this and went through all the plans that we're seeing tonight. And you can bring them up, we can follow up with them at the next meeting. And I am pleased that there's going to be a next meeting. So the first one is security, because in real life in Ward 4, we have a lot of residents who enjoy having parties and love sharing their music and their singing and whatever else, their fireworks, with their neighbors, even if they aren't right next door. And so I'm interested to know about security in the complex and what happens if one of your apartment dwellers does this, has a wild party. Okay. My next question has to do with buffer, because we had spoken about in that B1 building, which the back of it faces the street. And I mentioned to you how people like to keep things on their back porch, bikes and shovels and all kinds of things. And it's not very attractive looking from the street. And your plans do now show trees. But what I would love to see in a more perfect world is more the kind of plantings that you did to buffer the parking area that's next to the building that's now the chapel, so that it's less noticeable from the street. I think that's a great idea, and I think that might work there. Please consider it, and I will follow up with you. The next thing is, in my notes from September 23rd, we did talk about a playground, and I didn't get an exact commitment for it, but you can hear that's an issue with the neighbors as well, because there's nowhere on this side of town to bring your children. We're going to be introducing a lot of children, especially in 3-bedroom apartments. Children need something to do. Please strongly consider a playground. I'll be haunting you about this. And finally, I had a community garden that we had discussed, something for the residents to do outdoors. We all love that. I'll follow up with you on that. You know, this is, and I know that the developers are aware of this for me. This is very hard because the zoning changes that make a 175 unit project possible on this land were approved days before I came on the City Council. And my predecessor as Ward 4 counselor supported this and I opposed it. And I repeatedly spoke against it, but the City Council still voted to approve it. We're all aware, Rob May gave a very good summary tonight. This is a project that can be built as of right. And the whole neighborhood, this whole side of town is very upset about this. As was commented tonight, you don't hear anyone speak in support of this. It's being forced on us, and that's a shame. The use is allowed, and because of that, I spent many hours working with the developers, and they can tell you this yourself, on this and trying to make the best project that we can with the least amount of neighborhood impacts. And I've been very pleased at how the neighbors have done their best to work with me, and Councillor Thompson as well, and the peer reviewer and the planning department. In reality, this is going to happen, and I want to see the best, the very best project that we can, something that everyone, including the Archdiocese, will be proud of. Thank you. I'll follow up with you on those issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor.
Sorry. Thank you, Councillor. We don't have any additional questions right now, but I am hoping that the board will move to continue this. We will continue to, if they do, we will continue to work on questions that have been raised both here and in our technical review reports.
Yeah.
And I would also ask that if counselors, if you receive questions, please forward them to us. We will also be taking more questions via email, and we will put those into part of the record.
All right.
Can I just share a couple more comments for the developer to consider before the next meeting, and maybe to help ease some of the pain that this project is causing the neighborhood? They all have very good points, but you heard, you know, the numerous issues, concerns with the traffic, and someone mentioned speed bumps on the side roads. You know, you're the experts with your engineers. Come back to the next meeting with some solutions to comfort and increase the safety in regards to the traffic concerns. I would suggest you come back with that. Maybe strongly consider decreasing the size from 175 units, instead of lowering that. Definitely the outdoor recreation, more than a playground. I mean, this is a huge community. Come back with the commitments. So all of these concerns that you heard, come back with the commitments and consideration for them. Thank you.
Yes, we certainly hear all the comments. We'll give them serious review and discussion and review, and we'll come back with responses.
We all appreciate that.
Do any of the other planning board members have any other comments or concerns they'd like to make? Okay, I'd like to make just some wrap-up comments on my own, and I'm speaking to the developer and to our peer group beta, and that is that you've heard the comments on the part of the concerned citizens, the neighbors, the planning board. I mean, I too have concerns about density, about parking, all of the issues that have been raised here, about traffic. So I'm going to ask you gentlemen, which has been suggested here tonight, to get together and address and have some answers and responses when we meet again. As far as a playground, I mean, if you're going to invite families to this site, you need to propose something more than just a swing set type of a remedy. You need to, I don't know where you're going to place it. I'm looking at the density of your site plan here, but you need to propose something of adequate size and performance to in the way of a playground to accommodate this size project. I would think, and I would ask that you get together with Beta, the developer, get together with Beta, and do that. I'm just curious, just one quick question to the civil representative. Is he still on the call or is he gone?
I'm here.
Oh, okay. Is it Kuchar?
That is correct.
Okay, sir, just a quick question. So the three basins that you show on this site, are they retention or detention basins?
They are detention. They're designed to infiltrate, hold, and then release.
Okay, so in an average storm, just without going into a lot of detail. So in other words, these basins on an average New England rainfall, they're going to be wet for a number of hours at least until they fully infiltrate, correct?
That is correct.
So we talking 12 hours on an average storm, 18 hours?
They would drain anywhere from, I would say, 12 to 48 hours. I can confirm those numbers with you in the next meeting, but
that's okay, because where I was going with this, and I'm just bringing, I have a family member that lives in a southwestern state that doesn't receive anywhere near the annual rainfall, and these basins they use is a double function. They're actually playgrounds, but they don't receive anywhere near the amount of rainfall. And I saw your soil logs on your site plan, so I don't even know. I'm going to guess that the bottoms of these basins are probably just above groundwater anyway. So I'm guessing there's probably not a lot of freeboard between annual high groundwater and the bottom of your basins.
You are correct. They are designed to be very shallow. I think the maximum depth is only around 18 inches. So it's not, you're not holding large quantities of water as far as depth goes.
Okay, so given the rate of infiltration, there's no hope that these are going to be dual function basins. Okay. Okay. Anyways, but those are my comments and concerns. I clearly share the same comments and the concerns that the public does, that the councilors do. This board doesn't know what a magic number for that site is for density. It appears to me, to be honest with you, dense. We're relying, I guess, on Beta Group to assist us with that. The numbers seem high to me, but to be continued, I guess. I don't know. Any other comments on the part of the board members? Okay, hearing that, would someone like to make a motion to, I guess the comments have been heard. Would someone like to make a motion to continue? Oh, first of all, Pam, do you have a date in mind?
I do not, and that kind of depends on how long it's going to take everybody to get together, to get their responses. You know, I was looking towards the same time in February, because we have to continue to a date certain. If we don't, the legal ads need to run again and the developer needs to re-notify abutters, and I don't really think they want to go through that expense again. However, how much time do you guys need? Would you rather see a date in March?
You're asking the developer.
Yeah, I think, is there something, the first week in March, perhaps, and that will certainly give us 30 days to sort of work through responses. I'd say either the last week in February or the first week in March.
Our meeting is first Tuesday in March, so.
Yeah, you don't. It's hard to put this on a regular agenda night.
Can I recommend Thursday, March 15th?
No, you can't. What is, wait a minute.
Pam's on vacation.
Oh, I'm in April. Excuse me.
I was going to say, there is no Thursday, March 15th on this calendar.
It is Thursday.
That's why I said no.
Good catch. Thursday, March 11th. 18th.
Thursday, March 11th. Does that work for everybody?
I would say yes. For me, it does.
Yep.
Can the other board members respond? Does that work for everyone?
Sure.
Yes.
It works for me.
Yep.
Okay. Well, Thursday, March the 11th, date certain, you've got it. So, and that allows the applicant and the peer group to respond, I guess, enough time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Great, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Would someone like to make a motion, please?
I'll make a motion to continue this project, Thatcher Street, to March 11th.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, there's been a motion made and seconded, and I have to take a roll call vote. So on the roll call, Larry Hassan.
Yes.
Tony Gonzalez.
Yes.
Reggie Thomas.
Yes.
Craig Pina.
Yes.
Bob Pelagi is a yes. So till we meet again. Thank you very much for everybody's participation. I appreciate your patience and your expertise. So thank you very much and good night. Would someone like to make a motion to adjourn?
Make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
Meeting adjourned. Have a good evening.
Good night.
Good night.